Good morning, I'm Mike Navalio.
And I'm Nikki De Guzman.
Join us as we give you the rundown of the news you need to know today. In the headlines, at least 14 people are dead and dozens are injured following a volcanic eruption in Indonesia.
More than 2,000 elementary and senior high school students in Metro Manila are set to return to face-to-face classes today.
Philippine media groups slam the libel complaints filed by Energy Secretary Alfonso Cusi and businessman Dennis Uy against almost two dozen journalists over their reports on the controversial Malampaya deal. We speak with Secretary Cusi and Uy's lawyer, attorney Rui Alberto Rondain, later on the program.
And the UK will again require pre-departure COVID tests for travelers as Omicron cases in the country rise to 246.
Thanks for joining us. We begin in Indonesia, where at least 14 people are dead and dozens are injured following the eruption of the Semeru volcano. As this report tells us, hot volcanic sediment and heavy rains could complicate rescue efforts.
Drone footage on Sunday showed an Indonesian town almost buried in volcanic ash after Mount Semeru erupted in East Java. The volcano threw up towers of ash and hot clouds on Saturday that blanketed nearby villages and sent residents fleeing in panic. One evacuee told Reuters of the sudden terror.
At first, I thought it was a bomb explosion, and all of a sudden it was Semeru erupting and spewing volcanic ashes. Suddenly, it was all dark, like it was going to destroy the earth. My children were scattered around, my husband was not around, and I was waiting for him. Then we evacuated ourselves to the evacuation camp.
Indonesia's disaster agency, BNPB, on Sunday said the eruption killed at least 14 people and injured dozens on Java Island. A BNPB official said around 1,300 people have been evacuated, while 9 people remain unaccounted for. A weather official on Sunday said heavy rain is expected for the next 3 days, which could complicate evacuation and rescue efforts.
At least 16 U.S. states have now reported cases of the COVID-19 Omicron variant. The latest one was detected in Louisiana from an individual who had traveled within the U.S. Many of the cases are fully vaccinated individuals with mild symptoms. Dr. Anthony Fauci, America's top infectious disease expert, says it does not look like there is a great severity to the new variant, but he notes that it is still early to draw conclusions. The U.S. Centers for Disease Control, meanwhile, says the Delta variant still accounts for 99.9% of COVID-19 cases nationwide. Vaccines are known to protect against hospitalization and death against the Delta variant. So health officials hope they will blunt the impact of the Omicron as well. The U.S. has averaged 119,000 infections and 1,300 deaths a day over the last 7 days.
Senegal recorded its first case of the Omicron variant. A testing lab says the patient is a tourist who attended a demonstration in Dakar last month with about 300 people of varying nationalities. The 58-year-old man was visiting from another West African country and tested positive as he was about to leave Senegal last Friday. He is currently under quarantine and is asymptomatic.
Here at home, at least two COVID-19 referral hospitals in Metro Manila say they are prepared for the possibility of a surge in infections following the emergence of a new Omicron variant. That's after initial research showed the latest variant may be causing more reinfections among COVID survivors. The Philippine General Hospital and Lung Center of the Philippines have been admitting more non-coronavirus patients lately, but they say they are ready to reconvert their non-COVID wards if necessary.
Ang nagiging hamon naman ngayon sa PGH ay yung pagdami ng mga non-COVID patients, no? Kahapon nga ay nagkaroon ng parang nagka-surge doon sa aming emergency room.
Tuloy-tuloy naman ang pasok ngayon ng mga non-COVID lung cases namin.
The The Philippines logged 603 new COVID infections Sunday, bringing the country's total to 2,834,000. The health department also confirmed 156 new deaths, but it says only 12 of those occurred in December. All the rest were late reports due to issues with its data system. Active cases now stand at 13,852, the lowest since June 1 last year. The Okta Research Group believes case numbers will remain low this month, even with the threat of the Omicron variant.
Even if the protection is lower, because so many of our kababayans have been vaccinated in Manila and in many of the metropolitan, the cities are protected now.
Over 37.3 million Filipinos have been fully vaccinated against COVID-19 as of December 2.
More than 2,000 elementary and senior high school students in Metro Manila are set to return to face-to-face classes today, after nearly 2 years of COVID-induced school closures. The students come from the 28 schools across the capital region that were selected to join the pilot phase of in-person learning, which began in mid-November. The Education Department says the necessary protocols are in place in case a student or personnel tests positive for the coronavirus.
Lahat ng mga eskwelahan ay dapat handa dito at ang atin pong instruction ay kung meron na lalabas na kaso, whether whatever variant, ay istap po kaagad yung ating implementation.
Teachers and students who will participate in the face-to-face classes have already been tested and cleared from the COVID-19 virus. But a teachers group hopes more steps will be taken to ensure their safety.
At kailangan natin protektado yung ating mga teachers. Yung retrofitting ng ating mga schools, di naman natin minumungkahing may mga barrier, yung mga plastic or whatever barrier, kasi nagpe-prevent ito sa flow ng nung air. Kailangan na merong standby na doctors din at nurse. Gusto nilang mandatory ng testing, di dapat ilibre ito.
A total of 177 schools are participating in the pilot run of face-to-face classes in the Philippines. Around 27 million students are enrolled this school year in both public and private schools, from kindergarten until high school.
The COVID situation in Philippine jails also improving. The Philippine Bureau of Jail Management and Penology says there's only one active COVID case in the entire jail system right now. No new infection has been reported in 8 days. If this continues, granular visits for inmates may soon be reinstated. BJMP spokesperson Xavier Solda says they are now already preparing the guidelines for this.
Ang magiging sistema natin sa jail, isang pamilya lamang ang papayagan sa mga dadalaw, bawal po muna ang mga bata at hanggang isang oras lamang po, no, ang papayagan ng oras ng dalaw. 119,070 out of 125,589 were already vaccinated. Ibig sabihin po nito, ang aming total percentage of PDL vaccinated ay umabot na ng 94.84%. Samantala, 95,813, so 119,070 na PDL ay fully vaccinated na.
The Philippine Interior and Local Government Department will issue show cause orders against local officials over political gatherings held in their areas. The agency says local governments will be asked if health protocols were implemented during those events. The DILG is also finalizing guidelines for political sorties to prevent super spreader events.
Dapat may mga organizer yung mga tapos ngayon.
FDU.
Oh, pagdating sa politiko, yun ang nasa COMELEC na yan. Pag pumunta sila sa isang barangay o isang bayan o kung halimbawa gastusan nila security. Dapat gastusan nila security to follow the health protocol. Mag-hire sila ng maraming security para ma-observe natin social distancing.
More news overseas, Yangon residents beat pots and pans to protest from their homes against a brutal crackdown of a peaceful gathering. Local news portal reports 5 people were killed, at least 15 arrested after Myanmar security forces in a car rammed into an anti-coup protest on Sunday morning in Yangon. Another protest was held in Yangon in the afternoon despite the morning violence. Anti-military protests are continuing despite the killing of more than 1,300 people since the February 1 coup. The scattered protests are often small groups voicing opposition to the overthrow of the elected government and the return of military rule. The ruling junta has yet to comment on Sunday's incident. Now here's a look at other stories we are tracking today. We'll give you more updates on the resumption of in-person classes in over a dozen schools in Metro Manila.
And at 10 a.m., members of the Philippine Senate and House of Representatives will have their first bicameral conference committee meeting on the 2022 national budget. Our correspondent, Sherian Torres, will be covering that hearing.
And we are taking a quick break. Up ahead, we speak with Attorney Ruy Alberto Rondain about the cyber libel complaint filed by Energy Secretary Alfonso Cusi and businessman Dennis Uy against almost 24 journalists over their reports on the controversial Malampaya deal.
And the UK will again require pre-departure COVID tests for travelers as Omicron cases in the country rise to 246. These and more when the Rundown returns. Stay tuned.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
Welcome back to The Rundown, the headlines across the web. Inquirer's banner story online, the Lowy Institute says the COVID-19 pandemic has weakened China's power in the Indo-Pacific. Philippine Star's top story, the Commission on Elections allows 165 partyless groups to participate in the raffle to determine the order of listing on the official ballots. Manila Bulletin's headline, the Health Department says the country's health system is ready for the possible entry of the Omicron variant. And topping GMA News' website, the latest COVID numbers in the Philippines.
Media groups decry the libel complaints filed by Philippine Energy Secretary Alfonso Cusi and Udene Corporation Chairman Dennis Uy against almost two dozen journalists. They accuse these journalists of reporting false and libelous statements on their involvement in the controversial Malampaya deal. The National Union of Journalists of the Philippines described the move as a form of harassment. It called on Cusi and Uy to drop the charges on the 17 respondents. The Economic Journalists Association of the Philippines also denounced the libel case, labeling it as an assault to press freedom. The group says the media was simply doing its job, adding that Cusi, being a public official, is subject to scrutiny. Cusi and Udena Corporation Chairman and Uy are facing a graft complaint before the ombudsman over Udena's acquisition of 90% of Malampaya. To talk more about this, we are joined by the lawyer of Energy Secretary Alfonso Cusi and businessman Dennis Uy, Attorney Rui Alberto Rundain. Attorney Rundain, good morning. Thank you for joining us.
Hi, good morning, Mike. Thanks for having me.
All right. First off, Attorney Rundain, how were your clients injured by the news reports about the Malampaya deals? And is the injury really worth 200 million pesos?
Well, you see, Mike, I'm glad you opened with labeling the problem as the controversial Malampaya deal, because most papers, or at least the respondents who were sued, labeled it as an anomaly. That's the problem. Off the bat, they already claimed that there's an anomaly and there was some illegality committed by my clients. And, you know, they said terrible things about this being the biggest crony case in history, biggest crony gift in history, about a massive graft. Imagine how their children feel. Imagine how they feel. So they have to vindicate their honor by filing the libel cases.
Mm-hmm. And let's talk about more about the basis of Secretary Cusi in filing this complaint. He was saying that he was not involved in the deal. Doesn't the purchase by Udena subsidiaries of shares of Chevron and Shell require the approval of Secretary Cusi's department, the DOE? Yet you say in your complaint that there was nothing to facilitate. So explain this to us.
You have to segregate. The members of the consortium are PNOCEC, that's the government side, and then the operators, which are Chevron and Shell. The operating partner is Shell. The financing partner is Chevron. What Mr. Uy did was to buy the shares of Chevron. See? Mm-hmm. So it was a private sale. It was a deal between Chevron and Mr. Uy. In just the same way that if I want to buy the majority shares of San Miguel, that's between me and Mr. Ang.
But doesn't the sale require the approval of the energy secretary?
No, it's a straight share sale. It's a share purchase agreement. So no one else is involved. The problem with the alleged complainants in the graft case is that they assume that the government was involved. And since Mr. Cusi, being the Department of Energy Secretary, didn't involve himself, there must have been graft. But he had no involvement. In fact, if he had involved himself, he would have been sued for contractual interference. It was a private transaction. You have to understand that.
Mm-hmm. But aside from the fact that the DOE has to approve it, that's the allegation of the complaint, they're also saying that, in fact, the PNOC could have the option to match the offer. In that sense, they're also alleging negligence on the part of Secretary Cusi.
Well, there were several reasons why the PNOC didn't buy the 45% share. One is cash. I think they had something like 15 days to match the offer, and they couldn't raise enough cash. Second was policy. The country, these are not my words, no, this is the word this explained to me by Mr. Cusi. The country is just coming out of the pandemic and they need all the cash. The government needs all the cash it can get to pump prime the economy for normalcy in 22 and 23. Number three was pure political economy, because the government is already getting 62% from the transaction. now 62%, including its 10% share from the royalties of Chevron. There was no point in risking 26 billion pesos to get the remaining 18% of Chevron. Simple policy decision. And that was collegial, by the way. That was decided by the PNOC-EC board. It wasn't decided by Mr. Cusi by himself unilaterally.
Mm-hmm. I'm trying to understand, Attorney Rondaan, what prompted your clients, Dennis Oy and Secretary Cusi, to file these complaints. Is Secretary Cusi more injured by this issue than, say, the row in PDP Laban, which had consistently landed in primetime news, or for Mr. Dennis Oy, allegations about F2 Logistics and other companies he purchased, for example? So what makes this case unique that it prompted your clients to file cyber libel complaints?
The uniqueness is that there was an attack, direct attack on their honor and their integrity, Mike. See, I don't want to get involved in politics. The PDP Laban is totally alien to me as far as I'm concerned. But that did not involve attacks on personalities. That was pure politics. So you cannot equate the two. You just have to segregate the Malampaya allegations and the honor that they're trying to protect and defend.
Mm-hmm. Now, why go after journalists and media networks when you could have filed cases against the three complainants? Or have you also filed cases against them or complaints against them?
The three complainants have said nothing thus far except Mr. Rodis. And a complaint has been filed against Mr. Rodis.
But in their complaint, that's where the allegations are coming from.
There. See, I don't know about that complaint. I haven't seen it. Have you?
You haven't seen the interview with the complainants. So,
no,
I mean,
I've seen the interview with Mr. Rodis. I haven't seen his alleged complaint.
The complaint that was filed before the Office of the Ombudsman, that was the basis of the article, sir.
No, the basis of the article was the press release, was the press con conducted. Mm-hmm. That's according to Rappler and Inquirer, I think. It wasn't based on a complaint because I haven't seen the complaint. Mm-hmm. I doubt if anyone else has outside of the Ombudsman if it wasn't that filed.
Sir, I'm curious about that because you're filing this case based on news reports, right? That were based in turn on the complaint filed before the Office of the Ombudsman.
No. We filed this case based on news reports which were based on a press con, not based on a complaint. They say that there was a complaint, but no one has seen. I haven't seen the complaint and no one has shown me a complaint. So as far as
I have seen the complaint, sir. I've seen the complaint and the reports are based on that complaint. Isn't that enough defense for the journalist?
Well, if they have the complaint that's properly dated and properly signed and properly docketed, then that's a very good defense. But like I said, no one has shown me a complaint.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. The complaint that the ombudsman was based on findings at the Senate hearing. So you have Senator Sherwin Gatchalian who also spoke out against the Malampaya deals, whether in the Senate or outside in media interviews. But are you also considering filing a case against him?
As far as I've heard, Senator Gatchalian hasn't said anything actionable. I hear that there were libelous statements made on the Senate floor, but that's privileged. He's immune.
Yes, yes.
Mm-hmm. The interview, I saw one interview that he granted, and he didn't say anything actionable.
Okay, so you're just going after the journalist, and in this particular case, you have no plans also of going after the complainants.
Well, like I said, Mike, they haven't said anything except Mr. Rodis.
Mm-hmm. All right. Now, why file? Mm-hmm. Go ahead, sir. Go ahead.
They haven't said anything in public. All I hear about is a complaint allegedly by Mr. Rodis, by Ms. Nicolas, and another fellow, Balgamel something. But I must reiterate, I have not seen a complaint.
Mm-hmm. But why file cases only against some reporters, some media entities, for example? There are also others who actually wrote about this, but they were not included in your complaints.
I haven't seen them. Mm-hmm. If you have others, you can point them out to me, you can email them to me, and I'll evaluate. Because my clients are very serious about going after everyone responsible.
Mm-hmm. Now, Attorney Rondaan, why file separate cyber libel cases in Taguig and in Davao City over what were essentially articles concerning the complaint filed before the Office of the Ombudsman against your clients? And you're asking for 200 million pesos in damages. The National Union of Journalists of the Philippines calls this harassment suits meant to intimidate and chill the press. Your thoughts?
Okay. three questions. Why Taguig and why Davao? Mr. Puy is a resident of Davao, and that's his prerogative. Why Taguig? Because Mr. Pusi is a public official and his office is based in Taguig. Under the libel law, that public official must file it where his office is located. Why 200 million each? That's the value they feel that will recompense, will compensate them for the hurt that they suffered.
Mm-hmm. 200 million pesos?
That's how they feel. That's the value of repairing their honor. And your last point was, I'm sorry, I didn't catch it. Something about the NUJP?
Yes, NUJP is saying that these are harassment suits.
Well, we have to decide if we're discussing policy, Mike, or law. Because if we're talking about the NUJP's claim that it creates a chill effect, that we should decriminalize libel, that's policy, that's not law. I'm prepared to debate that. Mm-hmm. If that's what you want. That has nothing to do with law, because a chill effect is it's in heaven in a libel law. If you have a libel law, there's some chill, but it's tempered by the requirement of malice. That's under the New York Times, and Sullivan has adopted by the Philippine Supreme Court. What they want, the NUJP, as far as my understanding goes, is they want immunity. You can't have that. The Supreme Court has already said that libel is strictly construed in favor of a free press. But that does not mean the press can say anything to the damage of everyone. And that's what the libel law does. It balances. You can't have and say it's freedom of the press, because you also have to value the honor and dignity of an individual.
Let's talk about the actual malice, a key element of libel, because there's no presumption of malice if public officials like Secretary Cusi and public figures like Dennis Uy are involved. So that's why you need to prove actual malice. But is it required that journalists should know or ought to have known that the imputations were false? Or is the standard under New York Times versus Sullivan merely that the publication was done with knowledge that it was false or with reckless disregard of whether it was false or not? So different standards, I would say. What do you think, sir?
A little convoluted, Mike. Number one, it's not entirely correct to say that malice is not presumed. In every defamation, in every defamatory statement, malice is presumed. That malice is done away with under certain circumstances, like a fair and true report of an official proceeding or private communication pursuant to a public duty, to a civic duty. So what's your question? Do I have
attorney,
to prove
in New York Times versus Sullivan, the court actually said that there's no presumption of malice when it involves public officials. You have to prove actual malice.
Yes. Because remember, Sullivan was not a criminal case. Sullivan was a tort case. And under the laws then of New York, no, not New York, I think Alabama, there was no requirement of malice. So what the U.S. Supreme Court said that you must prove malice. We already have that. We're one step ahead because we already have a requirement of malice under the RPC.
New York Times has applied in subsequent cases, sir. Yes. Not just in subsequent Philippine cases.
The principles of New York Times. Yes, that's correct. That's correct.
Now, if you're looking at some of the reports, sir, that you cited in the complaints, and they merely reported on the complaint, and some even provided Secretary Cusi's side, but aren't these fair and true reports made in good faith without any comments or remarks of a judicial or official proceeding, which are not confidential in nature? In short, qualifiedly privileged communications under the RPC.
The privilege is a fair and true report of an official proceeding, Mike. It's got to be an official proceeding. So what official proceeding are we talking about? The complaint?
The filing of a complaint before the Office of the Ombudsman, is that not an official proceeding?
Until a complaint is filed, there is no proceeding. So if they're talking about the press conference about a planned case, there is no official proceeding as of that time.
So your position, sir, is that no complaint has been filed before the Office of the Ombudsman. That's your position.
My position is no complaint had been filed at the time of the publication. Whether or not one has been filed today, as of today, I don't know. Like I said, I haven't seen it.
You have not been furnished a copy of the complaint, Attorney Rondain?
No, I have not.
Now, there's a case actually, sir, in 2006, a GMA Network reporter and writer who merely reported on a petition that was filed, and the Supreme Court said that, you know, it was a mere narration of the allegations in a petition, and so therefore it wasn't really a case of libel. So, assuming that the complaint was filed at the office of the ombudsman, wouldn't this apply, this particular case?
It would.
Mm-hmm.
It would. But see, Rappler itself admitted that the reports were based on a press conference and an alleged complaint, which again, I haven't seen.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
If they have a complaint, if they have a complaint that they based the reports, released, I think, October 19, October 20, thereabouts, then that's mm-hmm. fine.
And is also one of your position that the side of Secretary Pukusi was not obtained by the media reporting the reports, because in some of the reports there was actually some quotes referring to Secretary Pukusi or the position of the DOE.
That's another problem, Mike. The reporters, I assume, attended that press conference and were handed the press kit detailing the allegations. And they probably called Secretary Pukusi and they said, Secretary Pukusi, we have this complaint against you and it involves graft about the Malampaya anomaly. What can you say? That's normally how it's done, because that's mm-hmm. lip service to the right to comment and the right to respond. Of course, the guy will say, that's false. I haven't done anything wrong. And that's it. That's the end of it. Now, that doesn't satisfy the duty to investigate requirement. Otherwise, if mm-hmm. you don't investigate further, you don't investigate the truth of what was said in that press conference or what was said in that complaint, then that's reckless disregard. Because like mm-hmm. the NUJP said, they're not, the Supreme Court has said that the press does not guarantee the truth of its statements. But at least you have some leeway of error, but at least investigate in good faith to find out what the truth is. You just don't publish what You don't publish rumors.
Mm-hmm. But consider also Attorney Urunda in the position of the media here. For example, if there's a press conference, there is mm-hmm. this claim by a certain group that they have filed a certain complaint with the Office of the Ombudsman. Mm-hmm. Isn't it good faith on the part of the media to actually rely on supposedly a copy of that complaint that was provided them and to get the side of Secretary Pukusi? That's not enough for you.
Well, if you have a complaint that's been filed, Mike, then that's good. But I would go mm-hmm. further. I would investigate at least a little bit on the truth of the allegation. Because the media has tremendous power. I tell you, I asked several people, even my brother, who's one of the smartest and most apolitical people I know. And he's convinced that there was a massive graft in this case. And I had to explain the details to him. You see, the Philippine press is fond of headlines when it comes to an accusation. But as the Supreme Court has observed, we're slow when there's a dismissal or an acquittal. So that's the power of the media. If you have that power, you have a corresponding responsibility to behave in good faith. If you get something, you have to investigate a little bit further. You just don't publish it.
In this particular case, sir, I mean, I'm trying to understand where you're coming from, because from the point of view of the media, are you expecting the media to actually look into every, for example, complaint that's been filed or any claim that's been made? Because we've covered, for example, President Duterte. He makes allegations against, for example, supposedly drug dealers that he names. And yet, are we required, in your opinion, to look into whether this is really an actual dealer that the president has accused of drug dealing? I mean, I'm just trying to imagine the scope of the responsibility that you would want the media practitioners to actually do.
So we're not agreeing on our terms, Mike. When I say complaint, mm-hmm. I mean something that's filed and docketed.
Mm-hmm.
If you see something that's filed and docketed, it's stamped, received, then you can rely on that. That becomes an official proceeding and you can report on it without fear of a libel case,
right,
because you're reporting on a proceeding, so long as you don't comment. Mm. But if you rely on a piece of paper that looks like a complaint, but it isn't a complaint, then you might have problems.
All right, so ultimately this will all boil down to whether the camp of the complainants can actually produce an actual complaint that's been filed at the office of the ombudsman. In that case, if they are able to do that, will you drop the cases?
I would consider it, depending on what the complaint says. Like I said, it's without the comment, fair and true report without comment of an official proceeding. First, let's establish that there was an official proceeding at the time of the publication. And then we establish whether or not it was a fair and true report without comment. So it's a layered investigation.
Mm-hmm. And so far, what about the case, the complaint filed by Mr. Dennis Oy before the Davao City office? We haven't looked into the copy of the complaint, actually, but what allegations are you making against the media for this particular complaint?
Well, the articles impacted Mr. Cusi and Mr. Uy differently. Because, for example, there's an allegation of graft. If you accuse Mr. Cusi of graft, you have to accuse him of favoring Mr. Uy and Udena in this deal. No. On the other hand, you have to accuse Mr. Uy of using influence to get favors from the government. See, there are nuances.
Right, sir. So what are you expecting to come out of this case? Will you consider if the respondents offer to actually apologize or in fact compromise on this particular case? Will you consider that in dropping the charges?
Well, it's not up to me, but I'm sure my clients are open to it. A sincere apology, a genuine apology. I'm sure they'd be open to it. It's not up to me. I'm just a lawyer.
And what do you say to allegations, sir, that these types of suits are actually meant to silence the media, sir?
Again, that's a policy issue, not a legal issue. If that's your problem, then not you. I mean, if that's the problem of media practitioners, they should go to Congress and have the libel law repealed. Like I said, great power comes with great responsibility. That's all. You can't have immunity.
All right. Now, sir, lastly, instead of filing these complaints against the media, why can't just Secretary Cusi and Mr. Dennis Oy face the media and answer the allegations?
No one wants to know the truth. It's not sexy, Mike. For example, when that press conference was held and they were shown a paper, purportedly a complaint, they detailed in their reports why there was graft, why there was an anomaly. When Mr. Cusi filed the cases and I released copies to the media, no one reported on the details. What they reported on was Mr. Cusi's pride was hurt. Another outfit was even sarcastic and said, now he's trying to make it appear that his act of filing is being patriotic. No one bothered to report why it wasn't draft, why he had nothing to do, he had no say in the negotiation between Utena and Chevron, why there was no loss to the government. This was all detailed in the complaint, but no one bothered to publish it. You see, so you can see how it's skewed. And no one, none of the respondents bothered to realign the narratives.
And then for the record, sir, we did try to also invite Secretary Cusi to this program after we interviewed the lawyer of the complainants. We did not get a response to our request. So is your client open to speaking about this and answering all the allegations?
He will speak through me as of today.
All right. We will have to leave it at that, Attorney Rondain, and we'll have to ask you questions next time regarding the details of the allegations. Thank you so much for joining us this morning.
Thanks for having me, Mike.
All right. In other news, the British government reintroduces COVID-19 travel restrictions due to a threat of the Omicron variant. Travelers heading to the UK must show negative COVID-19 test results taken within 48 hours before departure. The rule will be implemented beginning December 7th. It will apply to all travelers aged over 12. The UK also added Nigeria to its travel red list after England reported 21 Omicron infections linked to the country. In total, the United Kingdom has so far detected 246 cases of the new COVID variant.
China's securities regulator says it respects the decision of some Chinese companies to delist from the New York Stock Exchange. But it says reports that Chinese regulators are urging firms to drop their U.S. listings are completely misleading. It adds local companies are actively working Chinese regulators to have shares listed abroad. China's statement comes after ride-hailing giant DB said it's planning to delist from the New York Stock Exchange just 5 months after its debut. DB has been under fire in China as Beijing implements a sweeping regulatory crackdown. But authorities there assert recent policy moves are not aimed at specific industries.
Back here, or back in Manila, prices of ham remain steady even as Christmas nears. Local vendors say they are holding off on price increases to make it more affordable for consumers, adding there's not much demand for ham right now. But they say ham prices may rise weeks before Christmas. Smoked ham is currently priced at 450 pesos per kilo, in line with the Trade Department's suggested retail price range of 345 to over 1,000 pesos.
Good news for motorists. A big-time oil price rollback is set this week. Gasoline prices may go down by up to 2 pesos and 70 centavos per liter. Diesel and kerosene prices may see slightly bigger price cuts of 2 pesos and 80 centavos per liter. Industry players say the drop in local pump prices is due to declining demand in the world oil market, as more countries impose travel bans due to the Omicron variant. In the U.S., the parents of a Michigan teenager accused of murdering four fellow high school students now in police custody. Authorities began searching for James and Jennifer Crumbly after they were each charged with four counts of involuntary manslaughter in connection with the campus mass shooting. They were expected to appear for a Friday afternoon arraignment, but they stopped responding to calls from their lawyers, prompting a search by local and federal authorities. Prosecutors say the Crumbleys bought the gun as their son for their son as a Christmas present and then ignored warning signs that could have prevented the massacre. 15-year-old Ethan Crumbly is being held without bail and has been charged as an adult on suspicion of carrying out the deadliest U.S. school shooting this year.
Now let's find out what stories our North America Bureau is pursuing today with our Bureau Chief DJ Manotok.
Good morning, Mike and Nikki. Here's today's stories making the headlines amongst the Filipino community. The Manitoba Filipino Street Food Festival has held a mini parol making festival to bring members of the community together, even if only virtually.
Especially at this pandemic time, everybody's been cooped in the house for so long already. So marami nang nabobored dyan. So we try to create some activities that will enlighten the spirit of our kababayan.
Among the entries is a parol designed with used pull tabs from empty soda cans as a tail, a lantern made of dried leaves, and some adorned with poinsettia, tinsel, and Christmas lights. Most have the traditional Belen or baby Jesus at its center, while the biggest entry was a 4-foot parol from the Manitoba Filipino Teachers Association. And finally, at 18 years old, Logan Edra is already a world champion. The San Diego Phil-Am, known as Logistics, won the Red Bull BC1 Championships held in Poland last month. The BC1 is regarded as one of the top breakdancing competitions in the world.
Really happy because I was able to accomplish something that I've been working on for, my whole life.
Edra discovered breakdancing by accident after her dad tricked her into trying something new. And there's been no turning back. Winning battles and even competing on the reality show World of Dance as part of the lab. Logistics is now based in Miami, Florida, and is also eyeing gold as breakdancing will make its Olympic debut at the 2024 Paris Games. And those are the latest headlines of North America. You can catch our stories online at news.abs-cbn.com/tfcnews and on the ABS-CBN News YouTube channel. Back to Mike and Nikki for the rundown.
Thank you, TJ. And last week, 13 fans rejoiced the release of the Funko Pop of Filipino favorite comic book character Alexander 13. It was released under Funko's comics line and is available exclusively at Philbarz, the Philippines' longest-running chain of comics and collectible specialty stores. To talk more about this collaboration and how comic book stores are faring this pandemic is Chief Creative Officer of Philbarz, Ivan Guerrero. Good morning, Ivan. Thank you so much for joining us. All right. So first off, we get a Netflix series and now we get a Funko Pop Could you tell us the story behind this new PhilBars exclusive pop? Who were involved, and how did Trece creators Kadjo Baldissimo and Budget Tan react to it?
Absolutely. It's a bit of a long story. I'll try to condense it as much as I can. But Budget and Kadjo have been longtime friends of mine. I used to actually be office mates with them. And I've always been very supportive of the projects that they work on, especially when they started producing Trece. Many years back, Budget actually approached us and asked if it would be possible to produce a Funko Pop of Alexander Trece and some of the other characters in that world. And we approached Funko about it several times. Always, you know, we returned back to the drawing board and tried our best the following time. But this time around, I think because of the popularity of the Netflix animated show, Funko gave us the green light to actually produce Funko Pop based on the characters.
Mm-hmm. And even the comic books are again gaining popularity, right?
Actually, the Trece books have always been an evergreen product at our stores. They've always been very popular and always sell out.
All right. And Ivan, over a week since being released, how are sales so far for the Trece Pop? And for those not so well-versed in toy and Funko lingo, could you tell our audience what a Chase Pop is and how does a person get a hold of one?
Oh, absolutely. Well, sales has been pretty good. There's been a lot of interest in the character, not just locally, but abroad as well. We get a lot of messages from people all over the world who have been reading the comics through the years. And so we've been trying our best to fulfill as many orders as we can over, especially, you know, with the holidays coming up, there's been a lot of interest for this item for Christmas. Sorry, what was your second question, Nikki?
How does a person get a hold of a Chase Funko Pop? And what is a Chase Funko Pop for those who aren't really familiar?
A Chase is like a limited edition version of the regularly released Funko Pop. So this is our regular colored one, and we do have a Chase for it, which comes in black and white. It's black and white because the original comics actually came in black and white. And it just, you know, something that a lot of people read through the years, and that's really how they know the character. So we decided we'd produce a limited edition version of it, which can be bought as part of a 6-pack of Trece Funko Pop.
Mm-hmm. So you have to buy about 5 of the normal ones, and then you get a Chase one. Right,
that's it.
Okay, I have one there.
Oh, wow.
All right. Earlier this year, you also had these PhilBars exclusive Ateneo, Blue Eagle and the LaSalle Green Archer Funko Pops, right? Could you tell us more about these two?
So we were trying to come up with ideas for possible other Funko Pop that we could release this year. Well, actually, it was planned to be released last year, but we got pushed back because of the pandemic. And we figured we'd tap a few other iconic characters that are known in Filipino pop culture. And we figured the Ateneo Blue Eagle and the LaSalle Green Archer are fit the bill perfectly. These are mascots that are recognized by pretty much everyone in the country because of the universities they stand for and because of the basketball teams. And we figured, you know, it's a good fit because it not only is there interest in these characters, but they also help build school spirit amongst the alumni.
Perhaps a UP Maroon and a USD Tiger one day.
Yeah. We're gauging how sales are for these initial releases, and hopefully, if both the Alexander Trece and the University Pops do really well, we'd like to revisit both lines with additional characters and more Funko Pop in the future.
And what do you think is the appeal of Funko Pops to both avid toy collectors and even to the general public? What's behind the Funko Pop culture phenomenon?
Well, the tagline of Funko is everyone is a fan of everything, or everyone is a fan of something. And I think that's really what they try to do with their products. They try to translate anything that you might be a fan of into something tangible and ownable, something that you can take home. So if you're a fan of a cartoon or a TV show or something that you grew up with, Funko is there to kind of give you something that you can own and take home.
Agreed. Super. Now, more than a year after the pandemic, how would you say are comic book stores faring now? You know, there were some branches shut down before, but how would you say is the industry recovering right now, at least in the Philippines?
Well, it's been a slow and steady recovery. I would say we got a bit of a slump in terms of comic book sales the past year. The thing about comic book stores is, you know, it's a habit forming hobby. You really like the idea of visiting the store and, you know, talking with your seller and creating a bond of friendship with the people who stop by at the store. And so with the pandemic, it sort of crippled sales for comic books, especially. But I think with online opportunities popping up, I think that's where the opportunities lie for stores like us. We're able to reach out more fans all across the Philippines.
Mm-hmm. And you still get to bond with the community, right? The geek community.
Absolutely.
And what's next on the things to watch out for from PhilBars? Perhaps even more upcoming exclusives, more 13 characters in the future?
Absolutely. So we're constantly trying to push for new and exclusive merchandise at our stores, whether it be comic book covers. We've been working with a few publishers like Marvel, Archie, and IDW in the past couple of years. So we hope to do more of that in the years to come. And hopefully with the strong sales of Trece and Ateneo Lasal, we will revisit more Funko Pops.
All right. We'll be looking out for that. Thank you so much for joining us this morning, Ivan.
Thanks, Becky. Take care.
Meanwhile, in sports, boxing greats Manny Pacquiao and Floyd Mayweather set to face off again, but this time within a basketball match. The Philippines' fighting senator, who is currently gunning for the country's top post, says this will be a charity basketball game. It's expected to be held next month.
Ang purpose namin is a basketball game, sports yan eh. So yun ang ano namin. Kung ano man yung politika natin dito, sa atin ito. Iba naman yun sa amin, sa sports yun, basketball. Wala nang ibang time eh. Kasi katatapos ko lang lumaban nung August. So after nung August, wala naman tayong ginagawang activity. So basketball na lang.
Pacquiao and Mayweather faced off in 2015 in boxing's highest grossing match, with Mayweather coming out the victor.
Sige. It's December, which means it's time for another bumper crop of holiday flicks. From romantic comedies to action adventures, Manny the Movie Guy picks the best and new Christmas movies you can stream right now.
From Apple Apple TV Plus, check out A Gift from Bob. Based on the novels A Gift from Bob and The Little Book of Bob, this uplifting story tells the tale of a struggling street musician and his cat Bob and their fight against animal welfare, threatening to take away the beloved orange tabby cat during Christmas of all times. And on HBO Max, there's 8-Bit Christmas. Set in 1980s Chicago, this joyful tale has 10-year-old Jake Doyle on a quest to get the Christmas gift of his life, an 8-Bit entertainment system.
Part of It's a Wonderful Lifetime.
And over on Lifetime, the network is releasing its first lesbian holiday rom-com with Under the Christmas Tree. It's finding love while looking for the best holiday tree. And Netflix, the home of quality original Christmas movies for years, has its first gay holiday rom-com with Single All the Way.
And I can't wait for people to see it.
Michael Urie and Philemon Chambers play best friends turned lovers in this sweet and funny film.
We're spreading rainbow this holiday season.
Rainbow!
Also on Netflix, A Castle for Christmas.
It's about being surrounded by people you love.
Visit Scotland with Brooke Shields and Carrie Elwes as they play a mismatched couple. She, a famous American author, and he, the Duke of the Dunbar Castle. And another royalty Christmas story, The Princess Switch 3, Romancing the Star.
It's kind of, I've been saying it's like the holiday heist movie you never knew that you needed.
Vanessa Hudgens returns to her roles, all three of them. This time, they're solving the puzzle, who stole the Star of Peace? Our Capamilia will love that Hudgens embraces her Filipino heritage in the film.
Okay. My family's from the Philippines. We do hugs.
Yeah, of course. You gotta have some of the heritage. We need the ancestors.
And I just want to tell you, maligayang Pasko.
Aww.
And another new holiday romantic comedy on Netflix is Love Hard. Catfishing plus Christmas equals a joy to be had by all. And for a magical tale, how about the origin of Father Christmas? Christmas.
I fell so in love with Nicholas as a character.
Director Gil Kenan gives us a Christmas tale that is at times sad. Tells the tale of a young
love the costume. Manny the movie guy. Nikki, don't you?
Very
and don't you wish you have more time to actually watch all those films?
Mm-hmm.
All right. We'll watch out for those films. And that's a rundown today. I'm Mike Navalio. You can watch highlights, recaps, and exclusive content of our shows online.
And I'm Nikki De Guzman. Subscribe to the ANC YouTube channel. Like us on Facebook and follow us on Twitter. Head Start comes your way next. Stay with ANC.
Mobility will be key to recovery.